Proverbs 22, verse 12. The eyes of the Lord preserve knowledge. Isaiah 11:2, Revelation 5:6. And he overthroweth the words of the transgressor. The transgressor. He's going to overthrow Satan one day. And all those that transgress under Satan. Matthew 12 says that every word man shall give an account. You know, the Bible does record things that Satan says. The Bible records words that transgressors have spoken. We have the words of Judas. We have the words of Absalom in your Holy Bible. You have lies being recorded in your Bible, written. So when somebody says, well, the Bible has lies, yeah, that's true. A man. But God will overthrow those words one day. There will be a time when we'll never lie again. The slothful, the lazy man, saith, there's a lion without. I shall be slain in the streets. Now that's an excuse. It's not true. He's making up an excuse. He's calling out. Sick. And he's not sick. And the thing is, there were lions throughout the land of Palestine. There were lions in the land of Canaan. You read about them. Samson tackled a lion. David said one day he defended his sheep from a lion. So he's using a thing that is or was to be. And he's using, like, oh, I got, I'm sick. No, yeah, you can be sick, but you're using it as an excuse. Why not call people in the city who take care of it? Like, had to have been somebody who took care of a lion if he showed up. I don't think they just would let a lion just run around. I mean, like, we get these animals that run around, these dogs. You call somebody and they take care of the dog. I mean, you know, boss, I can't go to work because there's a strange dog. And you're not, well, you know, he's in his neighbor's yard and, you know, fenced up and tied up and everything like that. But, there, you know, there's a dog. He may get loose. That's the case. The mouth of a strange woman, and we've talked about her before, is a deep pit. He that is abhorred of the Lord shall fall therein. How do you like that? Sometimes, if God is angry, God will set a trap for you. And again, the free will, you don't have to fall therein, but the Lord knows you already. Judas had free will. He did not have to sell Jesus out, but God knew he would. Better not get God angry with you. In Ecclesiastes chapter 14, verse 10, on that verse. Verse 15, 24, 9. Foolishness is bound in the heart of a child. So you let them write you let them write opinions in the newspaper. What do you think? You give them a voice. And they do today. And the Bible says they are bound in foolishness. They don't know any better. We read about putting your children on a track, on a railroad track. Train them up. Why do you got to put them on railroad tracks? Why do you got to train them? Because they're foolish. I think he was talking to Peter one time. He said, you know, he said before he goes off to heaven, he says, you know, Paul said, he said, you know, there was a time I babbled, but now I'm growing up. You know, it's cute for a kid to babble, and he tells his little stories and stuff like that, but, you know, when he's 23 years old and he's doing that, it's really foolish to have to have a diaper. Now, you're a normal child, and you're 33 years old, and you need a diaper. Something wrong. I said normal child. I understand some medical conditions, but I'm talking about the one that's just grown up and there's nothing medically wrong with him. He just hasn't got rid of foolishness. But the rod of correction shall drive it, the foolishness, far from him. Correction will get rid of that foolishness of a child and make him a man, make him a woman. When they do wrong, you apply the rod. When they do wrong, the discipline is because they were foolish. And it will get out. Why are kids in America acting the way they're doing and committing murder and crimes that are just disgrace? That you would never have thought 20 years a child would do. Because you're not taking a rod and getting the foolishness out of them. You give them time out. You give them little rewards. You send them off to hotel correction, where they learn how to do more instead of get a beating. Listen, if you had a kid in the Bible who lived wicked, his parents would bring him to the elders, to the priests. And his classmates were there and to watch the child being stoned, yes, as grotesque as being stoned it is, but those children watch, hey, I better not act like that. When the siblings see one child sniffing and rubbing his hiney because he got in trouble and dad paddled him, they look at that as, I better not get dad mad. I better not do that. I better not get dad angry. America has foolish children, and the Bible says because they had not applied the rod. He that oppresseth the poor and see my note here. He that oppresseth the poor wages in trust and price freeze. He that oppresseth the poor to increase his riches. I'm going to pay you minimum wage because if I paid you anything more, I won't get any more money. I am going to put a price freeze on you so I can get more money. I'm going to raise my fees, my services, and you're going to get a less product. You know, everything you're getting today, if you drink a soda today that back when it first was done in 1920s, there's a vast difference between when that first soda came out and the soda you're drinking today, because today it's all chemical. When you buy food today, you're buying a chemistry set. But yet, science has made an improvement. They have raised the price of consumer goods. And you got to ask yourself, we are in an age of computers and robotry. A job that took 6 people to do back then, one robot and one person can do the job today. All right? You're not paying people. You're not giving them a salary. You're not giving them health care. You're not giving them a lunch period. You're not giving them paid holidays. Yet a machine is doing their job and the prices keep going up. My question is, why? Exactly where is the money going? It's not going to the computer. Maybe a yearly maintenance, but you're not giving him. You laid off 5 people for a computer. Why is the prices higher? Automation. Listen, when Henry Ford did automation of the first his cars, Model T, when he put them on an assembly plant, the prices dropped and more people could afford his cars that couldn't afford it before. Why is everything in automation now and you can't afford it? Because the poor is being oppressed. And when the government sets taxes upon a tax, and oppresses its citizens because they far spent the money they received and can't say no to a check that will bounce by the government standards. This country is over $1 trillion in debt. The people are in oppression. And they had nothing to do with it. Our government should have shut down a long time ago before that debt happened. Because that debt is caused by those who are in the government getting outrageous salaries. And he that giveth to the rich shall surely come to want. Giving to the rich? Why would you give to the rich? Political? Little bribery? Little campaign? A little extraordinary interest? It's an oxymoron to give to the rich. They don't need it. And the last church age, God's, they say they're rich. The proclamation by God says, the church says we are rich, and there are people that give money to the rich church. We are in a day and age today of $1 million, not more, put into a church building with amphitheaters and a coffee lounge. And when you give to that rich organization, the pastor and his working crew all have the big fancy whatever car is fancy. It used to be Cadillacs in my day. And you put money into that plate and you're not getting nothing in the Word of God. God says, you know what? What's it say? Shall come to want. I send all my money to that television preacher. Yeah, well, is he going to come by your bedside at the hospital? Will he do your funeral? You think he's really praying for your child, your mother, or whoever? Listen, the check goes in the bank and the prayer request goes in the dumpster. That has been caught, too. Bow down thy ear and hear the words of the wise. Apply thy heart unto my knowledge. Apply is a verb. Now it's funny because he says, my knowledge. Does he not? That's Solomon speaking. So bow down thy ear. Well, wait a minute, he's the king. He is the father. Why would this child have to bow down? It's an honor and respect. It's humbling yourself. You know, in the eyes of God, we think too much of ourselves. We're just doing just so fine until the next calamity comes. Then, you know, we listen to God. No, we ought to humble ourselves all the time before God. Sometimes we put ourselves right there where Lucifer used to be, over the throne. God, do you see that one down there? God, you see that guy? God, you see that? God, I think if you did this, I think, if, you know. And don't tell me you haven't done that. But if you were to humble yourself as a servant in God, say, Lord, let your word speak to me. Let me be all ears instead of talk. Guess what? You're going to get knowledge. And apply thy heart. It's not apply what you learn yet. Apply your heart to get more. It's a verb. For it is a pleasant thing if, free will, thou keep them which within thee. What? The words of the wise. The knowledge. They shall withal be fitted in thy lips. Apply to here, and then you'll get enough wisdom and knowledge later on to apply it with your lips when it needs to be. When you deal with lost people,
well, you know there's a 7-year tribulation period of 3.5 years. Antichrist is going to set himself up at the temple in Jerusalem, and you know he's going to behead Jews, and he's going to drink the blood thereof.
Yeah. That's knowledge. That's wisdom. You're not using it right. Because that unsaved God's going to say, at the temple in Jerusalem? You mean God's going to sit at the dome of the rock? You know what I mean? Now, if you were to show that lost person sins, salvation, the gospel, his condition, that is the righteous way. Save that other stuff for a Bible study. For Sunday school. That thy trust. 17, 18, and 19 go together. 20. 21 all go together. Here's a proverb. They fit all together. It's not just a verse and move on to a different subject. That they trust. That thy trust may be in the Lord. Bow thine ear, hear the words of the wise, apply thy heart unto my knowledge, for it is a pleasant thing if thou keep them within thee. They shall withal be fitted in thy lips, that thy trust may be in the Lord. You want to trust in the Lord? You got to humble yourself. You got to listen to the knowledge. You got to put your heart to it. I have known to thee this day, even to thee. To trust in the Lord, you got to put verb, you got to put into action. You got to be more ready to hear than to talk. And when you do talk, you got to be ready to talk rightly. Listen, I'm going through a thing right now. When I do something for the Lord, I am shown by the Lord in His Word confirmation that He's using me. And that's building a trust in the Lord, like, you know, look who I am. It's like, wow, Lord, look what you did. And look how you're backing that up. Don't get trust and confidence in yourself. Get it in the Lord. Have not I written to thee excellent things and counsels and knowledge? Whole book of Proverbs. Ecclesiastes. Song of Solomon. When you're talking about Solomon. God, the 66 books that are in your Bible. Now, the Bible says that we are not ignorant of Satan's devices. I would assume that that is excellent things in counsels and knowledge. First John tells you the three weapons that Satan uses. Jeremiah, Jesus, and Paul tells us what's wrong with our heart. I think that's excellent things to know. Yeah, you can know the seven dispensations and all the characteristics of that, but what is the application to your life in the Word of God if you're sinning? And you don't even know how to get rid of your sin. And you have no application to be reading through your Bible and God speaking to you about your own personal life. Never mind the guy next to you and that person you're going to deal with at the door. You can read and study your Bible and I'm going to show these people what I know. And you can't get rebellion out of your heart. And you can't listen to people who are trying to help you. Whether you know it all, whatever the attitude is, have I not written to thee excellent things in the counsels and knowledge? God has written to us the sins and the effects of it. God has written to us the blessings and the joyful effects of those. And God has written to us what it costs of our sins. And what the effect it can have on your life. That I, or continue on, that I might make thee known the certainty of the words of truth, that thou mightest answer the words of truth to them that send unto thee. Job 26:1 and 1 Peter 3:50, you better be ready to give answer to those that have a question. See, when you bow down your ear to God, to your preacher, to someone that knows the word, when you humble your hearing to hear the words of the wise, and not only that, to apply thy heart unto the person's knowledge, to God's knowledge, to the pastor's knowledge. For it is a pleasant thing, if conditional, free will, thou keep them within thee. To have a pastor preach a sin, a message about your sin. Yeah, that's me, that's me. You're sitting there and you're sweating in that pew. And you're the Holy Spirit working on you. And the church service is over and you walk out and don't do nothing about it. That is not the application of this word. When you seek God to get over, to get victory, when you learn something of the word that God knocked on your heart for whatever it is, and apply thy heart unto my knowledge, for it is a pleasant thing if thou keep them within thee, they shall withal be fitted in thy lips. Then you can put the application to your mouth to somebody else. That thy trust may be in the Lord. Then you can say, hey, it was the Lord. I can trust in the Lord. Whatever the situation is in my life, deal with somebody, deal with myself. I can put the confidence in God, bowing down my ear, being ready to hear the words of the wise, to apply my heart, the pleasant things, to keep the word. Thy word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against thee. I have made known to thee this day, even to thee. Even the words and what God has shown you. Have not I written thee excellent things. 66 books. All the sins. The adversary's tactics. Those who are righteous and what they've done. Those who are sinners and what they have done. The complete God-rejecting fools and what they have done and what they say. Lies that are found in the Bible. The examples of sin and the consequences. There are many things from Genesis 1 to Revelation 22. It is your manual for life. Man does come with instructions. He is without excuse. Have I not written to thee excellent things in counsels of knowledge, that I might make thee known the certainty of the words of truth? Here they are. Sanctifying through truth, thy word is truth. That thou mightest answer the words of truth to them that send unto thee. Thou mayest answer the words of truth. Let me give you an example of what truth is not. You want to be saved? You want to be saved? Really? You want to be saved? You want to go to heaven? Yeah, you want to go to heaven? Are you a sinner? You're a sinner? Okay, say this prayer. You're saved, brother. Come on down and be baptized. That's a lie. That is not the words of truth. You don't want to go to hell? Don't want to go to hell? Really? You don't want to burn in the flames of hell? Cool. Say this prayer and you'll be saved. Salvation without sin and repentance is not salvation. That's a lie. What the lie is, you know, being saved without acknowledging you're a sinner and repenting. The easy believing gospel. That's a lie. Rob not the poor, because he is poor. I'm going to tell you, minimum wage is robbing the poor. I have, in my time, I have been in a position in authority where by the company, there was able opportunity to help a mother with her children who was a single parent, and the company rules were, no, don't do it. I have seen them throw out rotisserie chicken at the end of the night instead of giving it to somebody who needs it. I have been, in my life, have thrown money, much, a lot of food into a dumpster or dumpsters instead of the company helping someone else. And yet, on television, what about the poor? What about the needy? How much food is thrown into a dumpster in America? Rob not the poor. Listen, you're supposed to help. In Acts 3, there's a guy that is lame at the temple would ask for alms. Even Peter and John knew this gentleman. They didn't rebuke him, you know, go get a job or you're phony. They actually gave him help, but the guy respected the silver or gold, but they gave him a healing. There are people out there who are, and again, you got to do it rightly. Taxation of taxation is robbing the poor. Not giving a man his full recompense for the job that he is doing or the services rendered to you is robbing the poor. And it's in the Bible.
Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Rob not the poor. How hard is that? Thou shalt not.
It just doesn't say thou shalt not, but rob not. It's still got that three-letter word there. Not. It's charging for what God has given you free. Having the government give you extra outrageously water bill instead of in the Bible's time where you went down to the public well and you got your buckets and filled them with water. There was no fees for the water. But they force you with pipes and plumbing and they outrageously charge you where you can't. You know, the people that you put in office by voting, and you can't even vote what your water bill is going to be. How come I don't get a comparison of companies for an electric company where I can pick the lowest rates? Why do I got to pay that one electric company set by the government? That's robbing the poor. This outrageous fees they charge you and money for the property, for land. That's God's land. God made the earth. Excessive amount of money you pay for rent and for homes. Four walls, a ceiling, and a floor, and then what you pay for it. That's outrageous. That's robbing the poor. Because he is poor. Rob not the poor because he is poor. Why shouldn't I do it? Because he's poor. That's an excuse. Don't do it because he's poor. Neither oppress the afflicted in the gate. You know, the gate was the city hall. Some of the people at the gate were the leprosy. Don't go oppress them. The beggars will probably hang out the gate. Like I said, the guy in chapter 3 of Acts was at the temple where the people went. The time of prayer. Don't afflict them. Help them. The entire function of the nation of Israel was to help each other in the eyes of God. You were to have poor Jews, but you were to help them. Boaz was the perfect example of helping those that were poor. And, you know, it even implies that Boaz had like an area for them to go get water. Because he tells Ruth, go over there where my servants are and get water. Implying that there was another place that they were to go, they can get water while they were picking the leftovers of the barley. For the Lord will plead their cause, the poor. And spoil the soul of those that have spoiled them. You will reap what you sow. If God sends a poor person to you, Hebrews says, you know, entertain angels unawares. And you oppress them, or you rob them. Mark your time clock that somewhere down the line something's going to happen to you. That's the Bible. Be not deceived, God's not mocked. Whatsoever man soweth, that he shall also reap. Now, you got to use common sense. Now, go back to videos and the audios, and I told you how you do it. You just don't hand out money today. That's just as wrong as not helping them at all. Because there'll be people you give money to, they're not going to do what they say with the money. That's plain and simple. Make no friendship with an angry man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go. Lest thou learn his ways and get a snare unto thy soul. Evidently, the Bible teaches that you can learn the way of an angry and furious man. You can be just like them if you were not. Anger grows. So let me ask you a question, my friend. Make no friendship with an angry man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go, lest thou learn his ways and get a snare into thy soul. Let me ask you a question before I make this statement. I'm going to kick a god, but I'm going to make a statement. Do you believe the Bible is 100%? Do you believe it's the Word of God? Do you believe what these two verses in Proverbs 22 verses... My eyeballs, I'm sorry. 24 and 25 say, let me read again. Make no friendship with an angry man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go, lest thou learn his ways and get a snare unto thy. Do you believe God wrote that? The Holy Spirit inspired Solomon to put that in there? Does it say make a friendship with an angry man, lest you learn his ways? Now let me ask you a question. What do you do when you get a whole bunch of angry people together called anger management? Do you think that's good? What did the Bible just tell you? Putting a group of people that are angry and furious together in one room is not going to help, according to the Bible. It's going to make it worse. Does not the Bible say that if you hang out with an angry, furious man, you're going to learn his ways? Anger management is just like prison. You go in there with a crime, you come out with more knowledge of crimes. There was a woman in my hometown that went in for bank robbery. She robbed two banks. She went into prison. She learned how to do it right amongst bank robbers. Came out and went on a year and a half spree of robbing banks. And she told the judge, I learned how to go this far because of what you sent me into prison the first time. And when you get a bunch of people together that are angry, it's going to get them angrier. According to a King James 1611 Bible. You did say you believe the Bible. And the Bible says you stay away from an angry and furious man, and you put a whole group of them together in a room. Somebody's wrong. It's either the people that say that it works, or it's the Bible that is wrong. Somebody's got to be wrong. You go in there, hear how everyone's been angry. I'm angry at my wife. I'm angry at red lights. I'm angry at my children. I'm angry at my boss. Listen, you're going to get new ways to be angry. Oh, I didn't know I could be angry about that. Wow, yeah, that guy's really right. I never noticed that lights were so long. The guy gets in the lane, now my wife, I'm mad at this red light. You know? You know Adolf Hitler was angry? He was angry at the Jews. How many people got angry at the Jews because of Adolf Hitler? Scientists are angry with God, so look how far evolution got. Atheism is angry at God, look how far they got. Be not thou one of them that strike hands, handshaking deals. We've talked about this. This is the sign, coal sign, striking hands, suretyship. We talked about it. Be not thou one of them that strike hands, or of them that are sureties for death. It's a hand in hand. Ever see some of these logos? Logos? They got a hand in hand. You're in good hands. There used to be a time when you went to the grocery store or the grocery mart, the little family, you know, it was run by the guy's family. You go in there and the child would say, "Mom wants a can of peas, sewing thread, starch, and she's and a potato, whatever." He rings up. It's $2.35. He says, "Mom only gave me $2. I tell you what, son. You shake my hand. You go to. I'll give you the groceries. You go home and tell your mom or dad. Bill was 35 cents over. Or if you watch a certain television show, and you want to sell something, and you made a deal on that in a certain Sin City, and you're one of the chess pieces in front of the king, the queen, and the rook and all that, and they shake hands when they make the deal for surety that you're going to get the money for that goods that you sold. When you're at a bank and you're sitting there and your friend wants to get a loan and you're sitting there, you're going to sign the gold sign. And if he don't pay the bill, you're going to get stuck with it. And you stand up, the deal's re, and everybody shakes hands in their office. There was a song I grew up, one of those ballads, and it said, "Put your hand in your hand and love your name," something like that. You better be careful, the Bible says. A co-sign. A co-signer is needed when the person's credit is not creditable. When somebody comes to you and says, "Will you co-sign this for me?" He is saying to you that his credit is not creditable. What's that say? Now, if you can go up and say, "Listen, I need enough money where my house or my car or something I got will handle," I don't believe you need a cosign for that. You know, there's a major electrical thing in your house you need to have fixed. Well, if it's lower than what your car's worth, and you can say, "Listen, if I don't pay it, I'm going to give you the car," you don't need a co-signer. But if you got your head out there, "Oh, a great big idea," think about that. A co-signer is needed when his credit is not creditable. If thou hast nothing to pay, why should he take away thy bed from under thee? Would you want to lose your bed if it wasn't your loan? "Yes. How you doing? We're from the loan company ABC. Mr. Jones didn't pay his bill." "He didn't? No. Well, what are you here for? Is this your name on the coat?" "Yeah. Give us your bed." Your bed, not Mr. Jones, your bed. Why should you be at loss? What's Mr. Jones going to sleep on? See what I mean? "Remove not the ancient landmark which thy fathers have set." Now, this is in the land of Israel. The boundary set by God. This is a law. And I'm looking now, let's see. H. Deuteronomy 19:14 and 27:17. I didn't look it up. But there's actually in the law, it says about that mark. You are not the Ahaz. What's his name? Naboth. Ahab came to Naaman and said, let me buy your field because I like your field. He said, I can't. That's my father's land. And the king went sucking his thumb and all that, and Jezebel had him killed and all that too. That was illegal. Naboth read Proverbs. Ahab didn't. You know, I almost got my father in trouble with the city of New London one time. I went out digging, I found this big old rock in the ground, I dug it all the way up and threw it on the woodpile. I thought it was cute to dig up this massive big column of stone. Well, it was the landmark. It was the property boundary. And to say that your 8-year-old son, or whatever age I was, you really had to prove it. I mean, they had to ask me questions and all that. But had you done that as an adult, that's a serious thing. And that comes right out of the King James 1611 Bible. You know what you're doing if you move that mark? You're stealing land. I had to, when I wanted to put up one section of fence, I had to have the surveyors come and lay out where my property was so that fence went on my property and not his. And you even got to put your fence 6 inches onto your property. You can't put it right at the edge of that line. You have to put it 6 inches on your property to make sure you don't go over on his property. Those laws are set in the Bible. Seest thou a man diligent in his business? He shall stand before king. He shall not stand before mean men. And I don't, I mean just wicked men. If he's diligent in business, it's plain that the king will hire him to do the business need to be. As we close another chapter of Proverbs.